Okay, iPhone people, let's get started. So last time we were building an app, and I did a no-no. I deleted the project off my desktop like I normally do. I don't have my project anymore. So I have something better though. The second part of this is actually done for you. So let me show you where you can download it. And it's actually not a bad thing to be able to see the finished example, even if you've gotten some errors. Or if you haven't gotten any errors at all, it's probably not a bad idea to double cross check it as well. But if you go into the iPhone application development link, and you go into example projects, you're going to see hello tab bar. You want that one. This one is going to give us the second part. Actually, it's the project we've been working on, which is the finished product. And I'm going to bring that up when I talk about it, because I don't have my partially one. I know I stopped right two slides before the end, and it was just basically taking another class and linking it up with one of the controllers, but I'll review. We'll see how that works. And then basic projects, you're probably going to want that one as well for tonight if you're following along. So these are the two that we're going to look at tonight that are going to go through some sample projects. And inside the basic projects, they're both zip files, so just go ahead and save them to the desktop. When you unload them or you unzip them, they'll be, this one has got a ton of stuff inside of it that you might find helpful as well. So go ahead and download that stuff. But the hello tab bar is the one, actually, if you download the file, what you get is this project folder. Double click on hello tab bar.xcode project. Or open up the one that you've been working on if you have yours still. And you'll see most of the steps actually we completed last time. But this one is going to bring up, and let me just show you what this project looks like actually. It's going to bring up a similar yet more complete implementation. I have a round for some strange reason. I double clicked on it, so let's see. Should be loading. I have a Windows Parallels window up as well, so maybe that might be causing an issue. Oh, it's building it. Okay, so in this particular project is using an, oh, do I have the right one? Map kit. Nope, I got the wrong one. Hold on. Hello tab. I had two projects open at the same time. The hello tab bar is using the storyboard and the storyboard looks very similar, so I'm going to kind of keep in with this one here. It's the finished version. This is the finished version of the one we've been working on. This is the one that's called TabView, which is out here. Just refresh your memory here. Refresh my memory. The completed version of the project that we're working on, under example projects, under course materials. I clicked on it. I'm waiting for it to open. Is hello tab bar. That's the one you're going to want to download. Okay, so what were we talking about last time? Just in case, you know, it's been an entire weekend, so let's catch up here. We looked at how to open up an Xcode project. We looked how to create, and then we talked about the MVC. We looked at how to create different components, such as the controllers and the views. We talked about automatic reference counting. We actually covered a lot last time. And the options that were set by default, the test cases. We didn't use test cases. We're not going to use test cases in this particular course at all, actually. Because this stuff is very, it deserves its own separate course, actually, how to use test cases and unit testing. We actually looked at the storyboard concept as well. And we showed, looked at the component with the first responder and the view controller icons down here. And I mentioned before, if you click on this, it will actually open up the associated object to each one of those different icons. I don't personally use it. Instead, I use the menu on the top to rotate between the different components. And it looks like we got this far as well. We found the labels. We dragged the labels on. This is the first part. Project, a Hello World project. We put a couple labels on there. We put a couple buttons on there. We pressed one button. It sent a message. We connected them together. We looked at the interface in the end in terms of the structure of the .h and the .m file. And we added some properties here. We had the at property button here. We had talked about IB outlets and IB actions and how they were associated with it, with UI labels and buttons and things, UI rectangular buttons and stuff. Looked at the synthesize, and the word synthesize creates an accessor and modifier, setters and getters, for you automatically. That's put at the top of the code, actually. And it says, within the .m implementation, we synthesize, and it's just create those things for us. And that's for the data members. So you can write your own if you want, or in general, there's no reason to. And then we looked at linking the rest of the buttons together, the touch-up inside action, writing the code for the touch-up inside action to change the label to hello, was pressed, goodbye, was pressed, depending upon which label was pressed. And we looked at the concept of the string as a constant, and so the at symbol was used with the string and to create a string constant that we attached to, and this is regular old dot notation. We use the self instead of this in terms of the syntax. So we said self.helloLabel, which is the name of the GUI component that we put out there, .text is equal to the at symbol for the constant hello pushed, goodbye pushed, which is basic syntax. Not really doing any object orientation at this point. And it self refers to the view control class. And that the property helloLabel is what we actually called it earlier. The text is the property, and the end is string object of the UI label that was displayed. So we looked at the tab controller concept, and we started building this project, actually. So it appears, in terms of the use of the tab controller, we created a new project. We created the application being a tabbed application. If we create the tabbed application project type, it gives us this. It gives us the controller, along with the separate views. So we have the tab bar controller, along with the first view, second view, third view, in terms of what it is we're working with. And we gave it a name, we set the properties, and here's actually a better picture of it. If you haven't seen this yet, I just showed you that a few minutes ago, but it's really hard to see everything in there all at once. We looked at adding a new class for the third controller because by default you get the first controller and the second controller. And then you drag and drop and you put another controller in there. Well, you actually left-hand click on the tab demo folder, select new file in this particular case. New file, a new COCA C file because it's the class file that's going to go along with the screen because each one of the controller screens, the views, has an associated controller class object, which is part of the model view controller concept. And so we could do it in any order. You can create the view first and then create the controller for it if you wanted to, or you can create, in this particular case, we created the class controller and then we attached it to the view. And we did that by, clicking on the object itself and going into the, this is the UI view, but we can actually click on the properties over here, as we've seen before, and basically change the class that's associated with a particular view. So we got that far. We clicked on Create. We looked at the associated files, the .h and the .m. Then you see out in the sample project here, we have hello. Hello tab bar, this is the app delegate, actually. I haven't talked about that yet, but we have the first view, the second view, a detailed view, which is a different view that's associated with it. And I'm going to show you this project in a few minutes. This is really just the completed version. So we have the set of files that we get when we create a new class. It comes with us automatically, so we don't have to actually go and create a .h file, go create a .m file. They're both associated, and they're associated in the interface as well. So when we click on the GUI, if we click on the storyboard here and we actually click on the item, we should see the actual objects change so that we can rotate through each one of the, this is the first view controller versus the first responder. We can actually kind of thumb through each one of the items as they're associated. We added another view controller to the picture here, and view controller looked like that. We attached the class to it. We actually dragged it. You can remember the control option. You press the control key, you right mouse click, and you drag it over. And we basically made it part of the system, part of the controller. We selected relationship, if you remember this part, the third view part of the relationship, and it adds a button on the bottom, actually. So we have buttons that we're switching through. And if you remember before, these buttons also had icons on them that we could select as well. We click on the item and we actually can change the label of the button as well. So, in fact, in this particular case on the view itself, we can basically change the label on there so it says third. And then up here, if you remember, it's this guy here that actually, this one here, that actually sets the class that's associated with it for the custom class. If we're clicking on the right item, it will actually, here's the UI tab bar controller that's associated with it. So that's how we're connecting these class files with the GUI objects themselves with the windows. We got that far. We did this as well, I believe. We got through the controller, assigned the class. And then the next part was just, basically the end of this was just deleting something and moving something around, is what it was. Wasn't doing anything significant. So unfortunately, I deleted my project, so I don't have it. But if you have your project and you wanted to continue with it, it's not going to do anything. It's just pretty much, you know, just basically going through the first, deleting the first view control. In fact, we may have even done this part, replacing the first, adding another tab view controller. We're doing this by essentially coming down here on the bottom, and, you know, here's the table view controller, the view controller. We're just adding them to the canvas by dragging the components over. We deleted one, we dragged another one over, we relabeled it, I believe, and then we embedded the navigation controller inside of it. So from Xcode, using the menu bar, selecting editor up here on the top of Xcode. If I press on Xcode, I see the editor menu. And then we embed, I don't have the right object clicked, so it's not going to do it, but embedding a controller inside of the controller, essentially, which is going to give us our tab view or scroll or table or whatever it is that we actually had to put in there. And then here, oh, it's a table view, I'm sorry. We added a table view to the navigation controller. So since the navigation controller is the container, there's a relationship between the two. And when you do that step, I don't know if I've got that far or not, but you'll see another item appear in the GUI, which is going to be the controller for it. It's the navigation controller. It will actually show up as a separate item. It doesn't show up in the screen, though. But it shows up, I mean, like when you run the project, it doesn't show up, but it shows up when you look at it in the storyboard. So hooking up the scenes, we're going to control drag the tab bar controller to the navigation controller, select the relationship. It's the same thing we were doing before, actually, to make that tab bar controller look at. So looking at the storyboard now, examining the fact that you've got more components in there, you can move the components around, you can rename the components, you can add new components, change the order of the components. It's all flexible, fixing up the tab bar menu items, changing the tab bar menu items around, naming the navigation bar, basically clicking on the navigation bar itself, and I believe the navigation bar is, oops, down here on the bottom for here. This is the, oops, go down this way. Here's a copy of the navigation bar right here in the finished product. And using the controls on the right-hand side to essentially name, so actually, you can double-click on the item and name it. So this is going to be my table view. If you download the project, you're going to get this. Essentially going through, this is the same step we did before. This is the navigation controller that we got from the embed. So if I click on here, I'm not going to do it again, but embed it or embed navigation controller. That's where we got this from. It was connected to the table view controller, which looks like this picture right here. We left the prototype cells up there. That would be for a separate kind of thing. In fact, there's an error message. It's actually a warning that we're going to get in this particular project. So we can get rid of that warning easily. So now you see the title is in here. So if you have noticed that you're getting a warning from the compiler of the storyboard that the prototype table cells must have reuse identifiers, well, you can get rid of the warning or you can leave the warning. Some warnings in Xcode are more than just warnings. Like, sometimes it won't compile. This particular warning is okay. we can get rid of it. It's because we're missing a component. So the warnings are typically not something that you want in your program because they could prevent some functionality from working. So if you're getting this warning because you have not configured the cells yet, so the compiler doesn't know what they are. So we could actually, and this is where we know that we have warnings because we see this up here. And it says unsupported configuration. I know we haven't configured it. That's why. So we can get rid of them. If we get rid of them, we can click on the blank prototype cell, and then next click on the attribute inspector and set the style to subtitle, which means we configured it. So the blank, and then go into the attribute inspector. So click on the blank prototype cell, click on attribute inspector, and attribute inspector is going to be this guy here. And set the style, oops, I had it. I thought I had it set actually a few minutes ago here. Well, I had it up a few seconds ago, I probably could have changed it. I didn't put a title up here, did I? Anyway, I can just set it to something. I'm just going to leave it alone because I don't want to bother with it. But in the attribute inspector, which is the tuxedo guy here, if I click on the right component, I hate this. Set the style, basic. Unusable identifier. Okay, well, I'm going to leave it. It's too much of a problem. I have to set it to subtitle, and it'll put this in for me, even though I'm not going to use it. So set the style to subtitle, but I can't get into the style because I can't get, custom. Subtitle. There we go. Now it's on. See, before, it was on custom, but it was unsupported because it was actually not set to anything because I didn't create a style for it. So the warning is actually still there, which is kind of weird. So let me save the project, actually. No problem, because I can always download it if I've ruined it. my two warnings are still there. Unsupported configuration, prototype cells. Yes, subtitle. I have it set. I'll put it back on custom. Well, it's complaining about this particular setting for the style of the menu, so I'm going to leave it alone now. We're going to worry about the warnings. Okay, so in the attribute inspector here, where I had the subtitle, I actually could put a name in if I wanted to and change it. But this is what it's referring to. You just saw it a few minutes ago, actually. Except for if I change this to subtitle, over here it changes. So I actually could put a subtitle in there if I want. Basically, the concept is this is being controlled by the attributes you're setting here. So whatever you set here is going to show up here. And you'll get warnings if something is not set correctly or something is undefined. Here, custom is sort of undefined because I haven't set a title for the window. But I'm not going to use the window because I'm going to populate it with something else. So, okay, so we can set more cell attributes if we wanted to. We can set accessory attributes to disclose the indicator. So here we can give the cell an identifier. If we give the cell identifier, we can use code in there to, we can put in here the cell identifier. This isn't going to really do anything for us. Can't get to it. Oh, well. Forget it. Here's the identifier. It's going to be a reusable identifier. But anyway, you can put an image in here, you can put an identifier, you can basically put your attributes for the particular component in here. In the particular example, we create things cell, but we don't add it. It's a things view controller, which I'm going to show you in a few minutes on the completed example, is a little bit more functional. This one doesn't really do anything. We're basically creating another class file. Excuse me, linking the class file in to the interface. So creating a new file. Same thing as we did before. This one's going to be called ThingsViewController. Same concept as we did, we're just adding another one in. Why? Who knows? Just because. Just to give you more practice doing that. Create and add to the project. And then link it up. Same as before. Going over here and linking the class to be associated with the GUI. And then building and running it. That was the end of the project, actually. So then there's another project, and that's the Hello Tab Bar, which is the completed project that takes it a step further with more functionality. So let me show you what this project actually looks like. And then I'll go over the pieces if I haven't ruined it, that is. So build successful, so we're on the right track at least. I should have an iPhone somewhere in the background. Here it is. That should populate shortly. There we go. And here we go. So this is a completed version of, with a few more steps that were taken inside of it, of the project that we were working on. So we have, now it just only has two controllers though. So we have the first view controller and then we have the second. These are actual, this one and the two are actual images. And the images were dragged and dropped and put into the file structure. And if I can find the images. Here they are, under the images folder. So I don't particularly like this format over here, but I think you can see, here we go. I zoom in for you guys. This is, if I double click on the image, I should see the image come up. It's the number one, actually. So close this. I don't like this. This is a PNG file. So that's what's showing up on the board. And the board, put the storyboard back up here again, has the tab controller has first view, and then we have the navigation controller. And it's like, what is the navigation? Well, it's for view number two. Inside view number two, we've embedded the navigation controller, and the navigation controller is holding a table. And here are the table items. So I called it my table view, remember a few minutes ago, that little menu? This is the table view that's inside of the view that's controlled by UI table view. That's of the second, it's the second controller. So we have the first view, loaded by the first view controller, and then we have the second view, which is interesting. So this is kind of showing you the layering and how that works, without bothering with the code right now. But this is nothing more than a table of items, just generic stuff. And you press on it and you've got a message. This is row 8. Basically saying this is row and it's giving you the row number. And then we have, this is automatically for you. So the navigation here of clicking on it, well, that's an event that occurs. But this part here and this part here, it's automatically given for you. And that's what you have programmed in. In fact, when I wrote in my table instead of table up here, I changed that. I can change this behavior as well. I can take this away, change the label. Well, this is going to be the label of the view. It's going to navigate me back. And then these guys are automatically as we've seen before in terms of the navigation. So this is what's really referred to as a tabbed application because we have the tabs on the bottom. We're going through the different components. We have other types of applications, and I'm going to show you the WebView next. And WebView is actually kind of interesting, so I'm going to close XView for a second here. Close this one. The WebView app is given for you in a project. I'm going to build it so you can actually see it because it's easier. It's called Web Page. I can bring it up and show it to you, but I think it's a little bit easier to show you the steps because it's hard for me to explain it backwards when it's already given and then I leave stuff out. So what I actually have done here is I've got a, let me make sure, this is the last slide actually. There's a link here, this is actually at this particular link, it's also in your class folder as we saw before under the examples. So this should be the end, it is the end, very good. So I also have this particular PowerPoint, this is also in your folder of examples and things. WebView comes in handy. I'll show it to you. It's very similar to the WebView, but it's a little bit easier than the Android, actually, because there's fewer components to it, fewer things. So this is going to be a step-by-step kind of thing. So we're still going to create a single-view application instead of a multi-view. So I'm going to go into Xcode, and I'm going to go create new project. And we don't have a WebView project, but we have a single-view application. So I'm going to click on that. I'm going to call this my WebView app. There we go. And then this will actually store the settings that you used the last time you went in. So every time you go in, it will actually kind of save that stuff for you. I'm going to press next. And I'm going to save it to my desktop because I'm probably going to throw it away again. Get rid of all these things. Now, I still have the storyboard, and I still have one for iPad and one for iPhone. So I'm going to click on the iPhone storyboard. I'm going to go over here to the little window down here, my objects library. And on the bottom, I'm going to type in web. If I type in web, I'll automatically see web view. Oh, that's good. So I want the web view to take up the entire, what I've done is I just clicked on it, and I drag it over to the storyboard, to the view controller. And it will automatically size itself to the entire window. I see there's a little spot up here. Interesting. I'm going to make it fit the entire window, because this entire sole purpose of this app is to show a web page. And so I can still go down the bottom and go, let's see, view controller. All right, first responder. And I'll get into more of that as we go through. But over here, I can connect it by, let's see. Well, actually, I can do it the old-fashioned way as well. Go into the H file. Move it over. No, I want to do, hold on. I want to get them both up. There we go. Clicking on the editor button up here. The hardest thing is figuring out and trying to remember where all the buttons are to switch the views. So the second button in is the editor view that I needed to open up. The editor view is going to give me this option to select, which is going to open up the same screen here. So if I go into that one, I've got the single view. That one's giving me the multiple views, as we remember. So I'm going to click, and first thing I want to do is add it to the .h file. This is the same pattern that you're going to use for every single application that you create. So I'm going to press the control key, and I'm going to drag it in here in between the interface and the end. And I call this my web view. Or you can call it anything you want, really. So now I have the property component added in here. If I hover my mouse over, we see it's connected. So I'm going to switch from the .h to the .m because I want to implement it. So if you follow this pattern for most of the applications you create, it's kind of like the no-brainer way of kind of looking at the design and figuring out, how do I get all the pieces where they're supposed to be? Well, the first thing I do is do the GUI. I know I'm going to show a web page. So I could spend all day configuring the GUI, and then I'm going to click on the editor. I'm going to open up the .h file. I'm going to drag it in. Add all the items in one shot after I've done the GUI. Add them all. And it doesn't mean you have to do it all in one shot. You can always go back and add something to the GUI. And in fact, if I wanted to, like, you know, if I was all done with it, I could still add something to the GUI and go through the steps again. But here I've added it to the .h file, and if I click on the and switch over to the .m file, I'm going to see the implementation. But what I'm going to do is load a page when the app loads up. So I'm going to play around with the concept here a little bit. Before, we had the page load up, and in the first app we had a couple buttons and we had a label, and we took and we worked with the buttons, and the buttons were on, you know, IB action. I was going to say the Android equivalent to that. So they were the IB actions. We clicked on there, and then we ended up with the UI changing, UI label changing with the buttons. And it was event-driven, and still this is sort of event-driven, but what we're doing is we're loading the view first. We're not doing anything else. The user's not going to click on something. I could make this and put a button on there, and on the action of the button, load a web page and reverse the order. But this particular app, it's just going to load. So we have this thing here called view did load, view did unload. This is the view. It's being controlled by the view controller. It's a single app, so we have a one view controller set of classes. And the file here, we see the end on the bottom. It's actually kind of a short file. There's only two methods in here automatically, the view did load and the view did not load. So what I'm going to do is put something in here on the view did load to say when you load, if you did load, load this URL. Because I have a web view, so I'm able to talk to the web view and load a URL. I'll load a web location. So when this loads up, it automatically goes to a web location, which is the goal here. So I'm going to go back here and see if like, step number one was a single view application. Step number two, modify. Well, this is another way of doing it if you want to. You can modify by automatically adding this particular line of code, which is the same line of code that's in here, except for, you can see here, whoops, you probably can't see here. I'm not on the same screen, but you can cut and paste and put it in. It's better though, I think, personally, if you drag it and control drag it over and put it in. That way you get the spelling correct and there's less typing. Because you don't have to do it this way, you know, just showing it as an example, you can cut and paste and put it in. It works just fine. So the next step is, in terms of, you know, if you were actually doing it this way, you wouldn't have to create the GUI first either. In this particular example, you're doing this first, and then you're creating the GUI. So you're dragging over the web view. You're putting it on the item, so you're doing it in the opposite direction. So in the view did load, we're going to create the URL request object and load the requested object into the UI web view. And here's the code that we're going to use for it. And I'm going to actually, you know what, I could probably type it in. You know what? I'm going to cut and paste it in. Let's see how this works. Because I'm a super lazy person here. I'm going to copy. I'm going to have to change it because the label is my web view. And I believe the example is going to call it something else. So I already have this line, so I'm going to take this line out. And this is different. It's not called web display, it's called my web view. And if I do this, I can actually automatically select it by pressing return. This is also another double check to make sure that my source is correct in the slide. So this particular URL is set to www.itu.edu. So if I run this project, it should load up, and on the view load, it should load up the www.itu.edu. We'll see what happens. You can change it, you know, experiment with it with different URLs. Oops, I have it on iPad. Well, I don't have an iPad interface. The WebView is not on the iPad, so nothing's going to load. So let me shut this for a second. Put it on iPhone, because remember we have two storyboards? So it's a common mistake for me, personally. So now I have it on iPhone, so I'm going to load it up. And here's my web view that has shown up. And there's the ITU website that has shown up. So I could put it on, here's hard set, actually. So if I change it here, it's not going to change dynamically. I actually have to reload it so I can, you know, put it on Google as an example. Reload it. It's going to basically load whatever on the view load, whatever website I have said, load it. The alternative to that would be to put a button in there or to put something in there where, you know, enter the URL. And if you're trying to learn this, not a bad idea. Put a UI, put a label maybe, or put a box on there, get some input from the user. Did I misspell it? Or is this really google.edu? Well, google.edu doesn't exist. How about google.com? Google.edu. There's google.edu. Okay. Let's see. Google.com should work, huh? www.google.com. That's perfect. You could experiment with this a little bit and make a web browser. How are you going to make... Oh, there we go. Make a web browser is you put a little box in there with a button, you know, that says, put the URL in there and then take the URL from the label, from the text box there and, quizzing myself here because I can't remember what it's called. If I type in, I don't know what it is, text field. So I can come up here as an example and make a web browser out of this by, I had it selected a few minutes ago. There we go. By making this, I hate this controller. There we go. Making it shorter, putting it in here, taking and dragging this over here as an example, stretching it out, putting on a, you know, say it's a say button. This is not in the lecture, by the way. It's just, but here, go. And then, you know, type it in here and take this and send it to here as a string. And you have a web browser. Why would you want to do that? There's a Safari on the phone already. But it's just an example of how you can connect the components together to get a pretty interesting view. So instead of Google, you can put on something else. And lucky for you, it automatically adjusts to the mobile version of everything as well, which is a nice feature. So that's basically how you would create a web view application in a particular interface. You can also add different other components to it if you want to. If you type the keyword view down here, you can see table view, page view, controller, you know, GL kit, activity indicator view, progress view, all the different types of views you could possibly imagine. Image view. We can do image view. We can do one like we did in the Android class. Put an image view out there. Go to a URL, grab the image, and put it into the image view. Image view holds an image. Web view holds a web page. Yeah, so it's kind of intuitive in terms of the naming. So as an example, if I deleted this guy here and I dragged over the image view, I can fill up the whole area, or I could just put it right there. If I clicked on it, went to the attribute here, I can say, you know, well, what's the image? Well, I don't have any images in here. If I had images in the project, I'm going to go to that other one, pull out the one and the two. I could put the image, you know, link the image, and then put it into the view by specifying the image here. If I wanted to, I could drag and drop and just stick it in here, actually. The older API, I haven't tried it in the newer one, but the older one, you could actually drag it and put it in the image view, and it automatically links it, which is really cool. So. Anyway, so hopefully you've got the view concept. You're starting to get the view concept, maybe. This project, if you can't get it to work, don't worry about it. It's actually in the iPhone projects directory. So another one, and that was the web page. The one we did the first night of class, the Hello World is in here as well. Tab Demo is the first one, Tab View. Tab Demo is the first one we did in the lecture. The second one we did in the lecture, by the way. Hello World was the first one. Tab Bar. Hello Tab Bar is the third one in that lecture. Example 3 we didn't do yet, but we'll just leave that one alone. And Map Kit is another one I kind of want to show you, because it's using a map view. So these you can download and look at and run. This one's kind of interesting because this one is not using, and new people who don't have the current version of the API are going to love the map kit because it's using yours. It's an older project, which kind of demonstrates the fact that you can take an old project, bring it up into the current. So when I mean old, it was made in 3.2 of the Xcode version, not 4.3, which means a dead giveaway is because it doesn't have any storyboard. Instead, it has this thing called an XIB. Main.xib. Main.xib is this window here. And so now you don't see on the bottom of the screen these buttons, first responder and the file owner. If you click on file owner, what you get is the old interface, actually, which is not going to show up because I don't have any files associated. I don't have any objects here. But you see the window. Oops, let's get rid of this. I'm going to go back on here. Anyway, long story short, the interface is slightly different because of the XIB instead of the storyboard. A little bit harder. You can still do the same things you just did with the storyboard, but everything's kept separately. So instead of all of the XIB showing up at one time, and XIB is short for Interface Builder, Xcode Interface Builder. So instead of all the windows showing up in one screen, you have different XIBs you're clicking on. Like here's a main map view controller XIB and the main window XIB, but they're not together, all on the same page at the same time. So the difference is with the storyboard is they all show up at the same page at the same time. Why do you want that? Because you can easily put the controllers in there. This is a little bit more difficult because you have to manually set. You can't just control, click, drag, and put onto a controller. So this is a little bit, more tedious. So let's take a look at the map view. We see we have the app delegate, which is basically going to be our data-oriented interface. So if I take a look at here, what I've got here, I've got a property for an IB outlet, which is a UI window, and another IB outlet, which is a map kit display view controller. So it's actually linked up with the map kit display controller. So we're looking at two components that are going to be the map here, over here, which is what we have, the map display view controller, which has our IB outlet, which is our map view outlet. And you'll see I have the same thing as before, but I don't have, actually here, let's do it this way. There we go. I still have the two components here that I can actually kind of, but they're embedded in two separate XIBs, but they actually do show up, which is kind of interesting. So you see the label on the bottom if I were to scroll this over. So what are we looking at? So we went down here, if I were to recreate this, and I go map, type in map, I get map view. So what ended up happening, you just drag and drop, put a map view on here. So what do you do in the map view? Not like the Google API, this is the Google API. In the next version of this, Apple's actually going with their own API. But we don't have to do a map key. If you remember from the Android class, if you took the Android class, it was like a whole big old thing to go get a certificate and go out there and get a key and then go take the key and attach it to the map view and all that stuff. Not the case here. All we do is you drag and drop, just like the web view, we put the map view on here. If we take a look at the code that's associated with it, let me make this a little bit bigger so we can see the code. And let's see, editor. And I switch it to the controller. I see what it's doing is basically on the view did load, which is the same kind of concept as the web view. Because we're basically creating an app that's going to load up a map view and it's going to take us to a location that's on the map view. It's going to take us to the same concept as before we used in the Android class, the longitude and latitude. So you still have that concept. But what we're looking at here is setting some, and these are messages. So as an example here, we have for the map view, send to the map view component, set map type to this particular type. Set zoom enabled, yes. Set scroll enabled, yes. Which is, these are messages that are being sent to the map view. The map view is this object out here. So this is kind of tonight's sort of your introduction to Objective-C. So, and how it's working with the iPhone interface. If you're not in the Objective-C class, we're starting from a slightly different angle here. If you're from the Objective-C class, a lot more of this is going to make sense, actually. But we created the object, and we added it to the interface, to the .h, and we're referring to this particular object in terms of its implementation. So in the .h file here, we've created the IB outlet map view, and we're calling it map view. So, and our property is going to be map view, which basically is creating a creating an object out of it. And then these, it's kind of like saying map view dot set map type, and then putting the type inside like a parameter. Let me make this a little bit bigger so you can see what I'm talking about. The syntax instead uses a colon. So if I write the C++ or the Java equivalent to this out here, and I'm going to get all sorts of different source code error messages because this is wrong. Oops. Wow. This is really set map type. And then I did this. Okay, this is going to give me a message. This is going to totally give me an error message here. Map type. Well, you get the point. That's an illegal line of code, but actually this should be standard. write my illegal ooh, look at that, it found it. Huh. Standard. We don't use the dot notation. Instead, we use this other notation down here. So these two lines are the equivalent. One of them's written in Java, the other one's written in Objective-C. What we're looking at is taking from MapView as the object, send the message set map type, and we use a colon between each one of the parameters. So if you have a separate parameter here, we can go like this and go second one. It's not really a parameter, but we can separate it. We use the colons. So instead up here, we can do like this. Now, second would be the equivalent to actually with the comma over here. And what we're doing is essentially learning the syntax in terms of a method call. So, and a method is a message, and this is basically saying, send this message to this object map view. And now let me get rid of this line of code so it actually works. So let me get rid of this parameter here so we can get rid of the messages. But put this back here. So we're running three method calls here. We're setting the zoom, we're setting the scroll to on and off. And then we're going to set the coordinate system to some region, and we're going to set the latitude and the longitude and latitude delta, longitude delta. We probably didn't have to set all of this, but what we're going to see is ITU location on the map. So I wanted to make it specific. So in terms of the region, we're saying the animation, yes, which means we're going to zoom into it. And we set the display map, created an item, an annotation for it, which is a display map allocate and initialize all in one shot. And then we're going to set the annotation here for the display map to title, to subtitle. I'm basically setting some strings to some variables. We can do this for data. So we can set title to something. So we're still using the dot notation to set data elements. It's just the method calls that are done in this format instead of the dot notation for the method calls. And then up here, we're going to basically, here's our function here that we're running, our method here to annotate the view. So it basically is going to, when we put our mouse over it, it's going to pop up, you're at this location, and show these strings essentially that we've got. And we're going to use a pin view, which is going to put a pin on there. So we're going to set the pin view, and we're going to use an NS message here to set the component. So what I'm going to do, because this is going to be way overkill, I have to actually teach you a little bit about Objective-C before any explanation on this code is going to make any much more sense. What I want to do is kind of show you what this does, all of the method calls with the object that we created, and this is the object that we're running. I'm going to run this object here and kind of show you the build of the app and how the app is assembled by creating these objects and the calls. And then, unfortunately, what we're going to have to do is spend some time looking at Objective-C as a language. So we animated the view. If I put my mouse over and I click, I see ITU. That's those strings I put in there. I can move around, and you know, that's basically all I can do. not too much functionality in here. I basically just have that showing up. Anyway, long story short, that's our app. And it's a lot of code that's written that's sending messages to the object. The object is the map view. So let's take a look at Objective-C. Because what ends up happening at one point, and we're hitting the point, is that we start looking at apps, and then all of a sudden we start looking at, well, what about programming the app to do something? We can drag a view, and this is like the learning curve. You figure out how to navigate Xcode. You figure out how to drag a web view over, drag a map view over, attach a map to it. And then all of a sudden it's like, well, how do we get to this location on the map? Okay, how do we do that? How do we do this? And then all of a sudden you have to start writing some Objective-C code. And then that's where you go, oh, I don't know Objective-C. So we actually have to kind of look at that a little bit in this course. So the other example, just before I move on, is a send mail, just to complete these examples out. Send mail is kind of interesting. It's using the storyboard. It has a press me on it, one little button. If I look at the code that's associated with it, I see the outlet's called IB, it's an IB outlet, excuse me, it's an IB outlet called UI button, same thing we've seen before. If I look at the M code to it, I see the button pressed action that's associated with it. And the button pressed action is going to load up it's going to create another instance of another class. So the instance that we're creating, let me see if I can zoom in a little bit here, is of the MF Mail Composer View Controller. Controls the mail functionality of the phone. In fact, I think that was the, I think I put this on the, no, I didn't. It only has one storyboard. This is an older project, actually, but it works with a storyboard. The mail controller I'm using, not to confuse you even more, but the reason why I like this is because I can set. So basically allocating and initializing the object, and then using a .mailComposer delegate is equal to self, which means you're still using a dot notation to set information about the object. So we created a mail controller object, which is basically calling the mail system of the phone, creating an instance of that built-in object of the phone, and then sending it messages. And here we're going to set the subject equal to hello world, set the message body, this is a mail send application, and run methods on this particular object to get the desired functionality that we're interested in seeing. The rest of it is just, this is all built in already for you. The view did load, the view unload. So we have the view did load, the view unloaded, and then we have the button pressed. So if you're gonna put buttons and stuff on there, you can still put code in the did view load, which means, you know, did it load? If it loaded, load this website, which is what we saw before. But in this particular case, we have a button on here, which is, well, when we press the button, we're going to get the button pressed behavior that's associated with it. We saw how to do that actually last time. So if I run it, I believe I have this on an iPad. And I removed the iPhone storyboard out of this project as well, which is nothing more than a way of just, you know, showing you that, where's this button? Here it is up here. I moved the button too. So I go ahead and press me. Look at that. I have a new message object that came up from, it's the mail composer object of the iPhone. So I easily went and I used features of the iPhone, the mail composer, and I put in hello world. This is a mail send program sent from my iPhone. Actually, this is an iPad simulator, not an iPhone simulator, but you can see how I basically created an application that essentially sends messages by a button click. So a lot of what you're doing is putting in buttons, putting in text boxes, having the buttons go and open up a mail composer object. So 9 times out of 10, you're finding an object that already exists on the phone, knowing whether it's a and the interesting thing with the iPhone, iPad environment, everything's an object. So you just make a new instance of whatever object you want to use. As opposed to the Android, where we had services and we had all these different components, which was a little bit more confusing. Yeah?
So you don't have to import the library?
Oh, no.
So all you have to do is just initialize it and you got all of it.
Yeah. A little bit more automated.
Somewhere easier to use than.
So much more easier. The only problem, that's what I tried to tell you on the first day of class, the only problem is this Objective-C language. Yeah. Java's easier. But Android's harder in terms of the API. iPhone is, the API is fantastic. You know, the components, everything is just so more automated and user. But the Objective-C code is a nightmare. So you got your pros and cons with both of them. Some people, you know, if you're a C programmer, you like Objective-C. If you're not a C programmer, you hate this environment completely. Java's, you know, a little easier. So. Anyway, this was the example of, you can see in the code here, in terms of, you know, you can see import view controller here, and you can see on the .h implementation, I am importing a library, but I'm importing message UI, which is giving me the message composer functionality. So this is very C-like. This is sort of like an include. So you are using it, but you just don't have to. You don't have to add it to the project. It's not like a service or a component, or, you know, you don't have to make a new controller or a new component. You just include it or import it. Which is, I guess, maybe equivalent. You know, if you think and look at the Java apps and, you know, looking at the map view and stuff. In Java, I didn't show this to you, but in the previous project, it did use an import of the Google stuff. And it's the same Google library, actually. It's being, in this particular version, it's going to be updated in the future, but this is still using the older one, which is all from Google Maps. So anyway, hopefully you're starting to get the impression in terms of the reason why I'm showing this to you is to give you the kind of layout of the application in terms of how it's composed. So in the iPhone project directory, that's about all you have. That's it. I went through all the samples that were in there. So I'm going to close this window down here, actually. I'm not quite sure why I had it up, actually. But all right, so we went through, we finished, did we finish the intro? I think we did, with the examples of the table view. And there's two more projects that are actually out here as well. And these are beginning projects for you, called project number one and project number two. If you're still lost at this point, you want some additional help, these particular projects are going to be in the examples, and those are here. They're Word files. The first one's Hello World all over again. The second one is, what is the second one? I can't remember. Actually, let me open it with preview here. Oh, I hear the music. In the hallway. I always think that's so bizarre in a university to sit here, music in the hallways. All right, this one's going to be Send Mail, which is similar to the one I just showed you a few minutes ago. So if you wanted to see the components and build it on your own, you can. Actually, all of the ones in the sample have text files associated with it as an example. We have the WebView. That's the instructions for building the WebView. So project number one and project number two, that's also in that same directory out there, is going to give you the instructions for building the WebView program that you just saw a few minutes ago, the Send Mail program. Okay, so let's see. Moving right along, we have to talk about Objective-C. It's come to that time in the course where we're going to be stuck. And so we have to learn a little bit about Objective-C so we can start programming a little bit more on the iPhone. And it's actually not hard if you're familiar with C. So, oops. And I promise I'm not going to keep you as late as I kept you last time. Objective-C. Because some of you are not taking the Objective-C course. I have to cover it in this class as well. Those people who are taking the Objective-C course, you're going to be bored tonight. So we're catching up with you. So Objective-C is primary for application development. It's the application development for the Apple's Mac, iOS X. It's the same language that's being used for the iPhone, also being used for the operating system. So you can build COCA applications and iPhone and iPad, everything all at once. It's used together with COCA, the NS class library, and the iPhone together with the UI class library, which is interesting. All your objects, and we just found out about this earlier through the Objective-C class, is from Next Step, which is NS from the next, actually it's not, yeah, I think it is Next Step. Next Step, yeah, which is what the NS stands for, which is the name of the company that was bought by the name of the, or that was formed out of the other name of the company. There's an entire history of it. I just went over it, and I can't remember. But if you're interested, look at the video from today from the Objective-C programming course that happened right before this one. We went through the entire history of this, but that was more appropriate for an Objective-C class. But if it's a COCA library function, and it's a method library that's coming from the base language, it's NS. If it's used for iPhone, it's UI, for user interface component. So in the UI view controller, UI map view, UI web view, UI label, UI button, or I don't know. You get the point. A lot of the labeling is with the UI. So it is an object-oriented language that provides classes, derivations, runtime binding, and also provides two extension class libraries, COCA and UI. And it is a strict subset of C, so one can freely include C code within the Objective-C code. So if you're a C programmer, you like this because you can just write C code. You don't like Objective-C? No problem. If you write C code, however, it's not quite as efficient. It doesn't use memory as efficiently. It's better. You're better off learning Objective-C, actually. It's a slightly different syntax. Objective-C is the object-oriented version of C. C is not object-oriented. So at one point, you're going to get stuck where you're going to have to learn it anyway because you have to know how to create an object. Everything is an object, just like it was in the Java class. So when I teach you this, I'm going to try and kind of relate it to Java. The good thing about Java is it's very similar to Objective-C in terms of the object orientation, but it's a little different in terms of syntax and memory and stuff like that.
Yeah. Is it similar to C-sharp?
No. We have C that's from C-sharp. We have C++ that's from, C is the base language of C-sharp, which is Java and C++. Mm-hmm. We have Objective-C, which is on the same level as C++, both coming from C.
Mm-hmm.
So the hierarchy is kind of interesting. C-sharp is more Java plus C++. And it's running on .NET,
yes.
And it's like the .NET version of Java in a lot of ways. It has like automatic garbage collection. The language itself is very Java-like. C++ is a breed of its own. Objective-C is kind of like Smalltalk in C++. It has Smalltalk syntax and C++ object orientation. All of them come from C. So it's kind of interesting. And in fact, Objective-C and C++ are very similar. You can still program in C with both of those two languages, which is kind of interesting. And C-sharp, you can program in C as well. So, and actually, you can use Java concepts. So it's kind of interesting. The history of C-sharp, though, it's the newest one, or newer, I should say, than some of the Objective-C's or the C++'s that have been around for years. But C-sharp is like the .NET implementation. And .NET is actually kind of similar to the JVM, if you think about it. It's an operating system on top of an operating system. Only problem with .NET, especially if you use Visual Studio .NET, you create anything in it, you have to run it on a .NET platform. It doesn't work. Like if you have Windows XP, no .NET, no work. Which is kind of a bummer. So it just kind of reminds you, you have to load the JVM, which is the .NET platform. But instead of calling it a JVM, they call it a platform. So, okay, back to Objective-C. So you can compile with a GCC compiler on a Mac, just like you do GCC, just like you do C code. So this course teaches you detailed syntax, yada yada, drill quizzes, okay, da-da-da-da. Okay, so let's take a look at the components here. Runtime, classes, objects, and messages. This is not a full Objective-C course. I teach a class called Objective-C Programming. That's where you're going to learn. This is an iPhone class. Just want to say that up front. I can't go through the entire language and the iPhone platform, especially not in 8 weeks, all in one class. So most of you are taking it simultaneously, but unfortunately some of you aren't. So I'm hoping that you're all able to get familiar at least with the iPhone features and learn the Objective-C as you go. So the lecture focuses on these three concepts. Let's talk about runtime. So Objective-C needs a compiler like the C language, also runtime system, which executes the compiled code. Everything is dynamically run. Only a small percentage of the language is compile timed or static, which makes it a truly a dynamic language. So it creates objects and messages, allocates and frees memory, won't need to know very much about the runtime system. All you have to do is know how to work with it. So in order to make an object in the runtime environment, you have to allocate space for the object. And then you have to initialize the object, which is where that alloc and the init came into place. And in order to do that, we send these messages to the object. An alloc is one of those messages that you can send to any object. It's a generic word. It's kind of like the C days when you said, alloc, or malloc, excuse me, which turned into new in C++. So in C++, we have new and we have delete. Java, we have new. So when we said person, my person equals new person, then that's equivalent to saying my person alloc init. Because we need to initialize the object, we need to allocate the object, and that's actually two statements in one. So remember when we could create, let me see, person my person, semicolon. That's like saying person alloc, which is generic actually, because we're not giving it a name yet, no reference. And we're saying, then we're saying my person equals new person. So we can do it in two steps, we can do it in one step. Same kind of concept applies, same theory, different syntax. So we allocate memory space. If we allocate, then we gotta release it, we gotta get rid of it. So we can create a memory pool, stick everything in the pool, and then drain the pool, which is what the examples are doing. And they use the word terminal, you don't have to call it drain pool while you're draining it, but you don't have to call it pool. You can call it my memory. You can call it anything you want. But the concept being you're just allocating some space, filling it up, and then deallocating the entire space. In the current version of Xcode, you can use, even in the previous one, you can auto-release, auto-allocate. You can have the system automatically do things for you, setting a generic pattern. So depending upon your skill set, you can do it more detailed through allocation and deallocation and releasing, and you can get it down to the nitty-gritty detail and everything. Or you can let Xcode handle some of it for you. The automatic reference counting feature doesn't allocate or deallocate. It basically just keeps track of references for you. And then you can clear it, you know, depending upon what's, you know, the reference count. Then that's how much you got. That's what you keep. That's what you don't keep. I'll talk about reference counting in a separate lecture, actually. So this is where the confusion comes into place, because there's no garbage collection, which you get in Java. So on the Android phone, in Java, we never allocated anything. We never said delete on anything. We just knew this, knew this, knew this, knew this. Because the JVM did what was called automatic garbage collection. If you weren't using it, it got rid of it. Why do we need to do that? Because on an iPhone app, we can actually fill it up. Fill up all the memory, crash the program. Same thing we can do in C++ or Objective-C on a non-phone device, just on a regular old operating system. We can allocate all we want till we run out of memory. It's not very safe, because we're going to run out of memory, the whole system's going to die. Instead, you're supposed to allocate, deallocate, make room. So it's called a memory leak. When you allocate, and a lot of that stuff out there is not being used anymore, well, you're leaking out the available memory that you have left. And so eventually you have no memory left, and your program either runs like a snail or doesn't run at all, one or the other. So memory is kind of an issue. We don't really need to know how the runtime environment works, but we need to know how to manage the memory for it. And we just have to make sure we put a couple of things in there, and I'll show you that. So more about the Objective-C 2.0 Runtime Programming Guide has stuff on. And we're actually working on the 2.0 version of Objective-C. It's not that old. 2.0 came out with the OS X. Prior to OS X, we had 1.0. And if you guys remember how long ago OS X came out for those Mac people, has it been that long? Maybe 2000-ish? 2001? 2002, maybe? Before then, we had a different version of it. Actually, before then, we had the Power PCs. We didn't have the Intel processors either. But that significantly changed because the operating system is Objective-C. It's written in Objective-C, so the version changed because the libraries changed because the operating system changed. So 2.0 is the, you don't have to know, that's just a trivia piece, but 2.0 is the current version. Classes. Classes are blueprints for objects, so they're like layouts or plans. So they specify, and this is basically the same as in the Java interpretation, but a little refresher and some tiny little tidbits that go along with it. So they specify the data and the object processes, the operations, the data. The object can perform on these data when a message is sent to an object. Operation with this name is performed on the object using the object's data and the message parameters. So the class is the blueprint, same as Java. We create a class. When the class is being run by the driver program, becomes an object. The object gets loaded up into memory. So the objects are created at runtime, and they only have a limited lifespan to them. Objects associated data with operations can be performed. These operations are called methods. Same as before, the messages are the methods. In Objective-C, they call them messages. In Java, we call them methods or functions. So these are messages because we send messages to objects to get them to do stuff, which is more of a small talk, actually, kind of language concept. So we're looking a lot with objects throughout this particular course. Messages are the methods. So the objects are sent a message during the running of the program, receives the message. The receiver of the message is the receiver. So we always go receiver space message. So my person space jump. So it's almost like speaking. Student sit, student stand, student run, student take test, student write program. So student what?
Student faint.
Student go, student faint. Essentially, your example is correct. It's the receiver of the object plus the message. So if you kind of, and this is kind of the small, okay, so Smalltalk was a language that was developed to teach kids how to program with building blocks, and the building blocks were the objects. You sent messages, yeah. So door open, door shut, you know, and you basically talked like that. It was small, very few words. Told the object, do something. Object, which is essentially what you're doing here. So if you begin to think that way, just think small, then it starts making sense to you. So my view controller, open. My view controller, close. You know, send message, get response. So it goes receiver plus message, and it's inside of brackets, actually, which is kind of weird. So. So it receives a message, will execute a particular method, Objective-C, follows a special syntax for the message. We'll see in the syntax, it's actually inside of brackets. So we go opening bracket, the object, which is the receiver of the message, space, the message, closing bracket, which is kind of the unit of the message or the sentence that you're running. When you run the programs, Objective-C programs, you can run them on a command line. Actually, you can load iPhone apps through the simulator on a command line. You can write iPhone without using Xcode. You can actually write it with a command line, notepad, or whatever. Yeah. You don't have to use Xcode for it either. Small programs have interfaces and implement together. In the same file as we've seen before, we have the .m extension, we have the .h file. If we don't have the .h, if we only have one file, we're going to have the .m, which is the implementation. We really want both together because one's going to have the kind of the specification or the interface, and the other one's going to have the implementation in it. The GCC compiler creates a .out file. It's actually it's compatible with C++, actually. I mean, in terms of the GCC compiler, I shouldn't say C++, C. It's a C-compatible compiler. If the same compiler is being used to compile C code that's being used to compile Objective-C code, it's telling you it's rooted from the same language, it just has different library sets, is what the issue is. It's the same root, the same language. And if you run it from the command line, you can run it with a GCC space my program dot L, and then the framework. The framework is the foundation. Foundation is the framework. And if you take the Objective-C course, I've already gone through this stuff, but the framework is essentially giving us the COCA interfaces and the libraries. You can actually compile iPhone applications this way by including, it's a tedious, long job. In fact, you can make a makefile out of it and configure it, pre-configure it, so you use the same makefile over and over again and mix it. If you really like command line compilation, otherwise use Xcode. Xcode is so much more automated. So let's take a little, I promise I'm not going to keep this that long. Just go a little bit further here. I'm going to get through, this only has 7 slides in it. These are really short lectures. So that was number 2, this is number 3. Writing initializer. So we had to init. So alloc, when we said name of the object space alloc. What we do is to send a message that says initialize yourself, or not initialize, create some memory, alloc, to this object. So our hello world number 1 would have an object called hello world. We say hello world space alloc. allocate it. And then we always see init next to initialize it. It's kind of like saying run the constructor in a sort of roundabout way. So we can have it init. So in terms of writing initializers, the correct initializer must comply with the following. Let's talk about initializers. The initializer name should begin with init, init. Because when we say init, it's an explicit way of running the initializer. The initializer is sort of like the constructor in other languages, but it's not exactly the equivalent. Because initializers don't actually get inherited the same way. Actually, constructors don't get inherited the same way in Java either. But there's a few little things, but that's the rough equivalence in terms of the concept. Initializer returns initialize object self. So initializers are used with objects, and you write them in your code to create the objects, set the variable, everything a constructor does. But you don't actually have to have code in it. It can be a, you know, it can just basically just not set anything, just initialize. It returns self. So we get, that's where the self comes into place. We don't actually have self until it's initialized. Because we can have references that are loaded up into memory. When they're initialized, then we have the access to the memory, if you want to think of it that way. Because when we call self, we're going to the memory address or where the object is located. So initializer calls the initializer of the superclass, kind of like the constructors do. This will propagate up the chain of inheritance until finally the init of the NS class object is called. Why they just didn't make these constructors, don't know. Okay, so initializer uses the value returned by the superclasses in it. So initializers must consider the correct handle for the construction errors that might exist as well. There's no error handling, no error checking them. There's no throwing of exceptions. The programmer has to do everything. So here's some syntax. So here's the method syntax. And we'll see examples of initializers, and we'll see examples of method calls and method syntaxes. But the biggest difference in terms of the syntax is with the methods, and with the initializers, and with the alloc. Everything else is Java code all over again, or C code all over again. Because C, if you think about it, C++ code and Java code are very similar. You know, integer I, you know, all of the different mathematical operations, the if, then, else, is identical. All of your constructs, your flow control, identical. Except for in Objective-C, we can use structures. We don't have structures in Java. We can use pointers. We don't have pointers in Java. So there's a few differences. So the definition is preceded by a plus or a minus. We have a bunch of symbols in Objective-C. So the plus and the minus returns the type as a cast. So a minus float result is a method declaration of a method called result with a data type float that's an instance method. So plus is class level, minus is instance level. So there's no static, there's no virtual, there's no, my virtual would be an abstract actually, there's no abstract. There's just pluses and minuses that precede the method declaration. So if a method has no parameters, the definition and the call consists only of the method name. This one doesn't have any parameters. It's just minus, which is saying it's an instance, float, result. And this is the data. So they put the data type in brackets, and the parameters don't end up with the brackets. So it's kind of weird, actually. You'd think, you know, but who says you have to put brackets for the parameters? So each parameter is represented by a colon instead. So it's followed by the parameter cast as a C cast, which is actually a more C syntax, followed by a parameter name. So here we have method number one, which is the name of the parameter, colon, integer, which is the data type for parameter number one. So people look at this and go, wait a minute, what do you mean by that?
There's no type for the method.
Because the method is already defined in a previous step. This is just showing you the variables. You could do it all in one shot, actually, and define, you could put the method data type up here, and you can also put this, or you can put it this way. This is just defining the parameter that's associated with the method. I know. It's like there's too many. In fact, you'll see the whole thing right here, actually. There's too many syntax variations. You can go alloc and initialize all in one shot, or you can do two separate shots with that, too. You don't have to allocate and initialize all in one, either. So, but this is not correct, however. You can't write this. You actually have to write it like this. This is just showing you this part. It's for illustrative purposes. This is not legal syntax code. This is legal syntax code. This is legal syntax code. So before each one of the colons, one can put a label in there. The labels become part of the method name, or you can leave the labels out. So compare the two definitions below here. We have method that's an instance method. Float is the data type. It's sum. It's taking on colon A, colon B, and colon C. Or we have labels, where we have minus float. We have sum of A, colon A, and B, colon B, and C, colon C. So we're putting labels on it instead of going A, B, and C. Labels and variables. Don't worry about it. Wednesday, we're going to write Objective-C programs. We're going to write Hello World. We're going to write some stuff and create some methods and stuff like that. So here's some examples. We have a definition. And we have the example of the call that's being used. So we have same method as we saw in the previous slide, actually. It's going to return A plus B plus C, which is the name of the parameters. A lot of people like this. This is very, very common here. This is the object that we're going to create. And we're going to send a message sum to this object. Because this is a method that's inside of the object that we've created. So we said previous life, we said object obj1, ob1, whatever. Run sum. Sum 1 is 1.1, 2.2, 3.3. We just gave it the values that are going to be filled in for A, B, and C. Or we can say sum of A and B and C, return A plus B plus C. And here we have sum of A, 1.1, and B. We have to put the labels in. So we're putting the labels in. So this is a little clearer because we remember that this label is this one, this one is this one, this one is this one, instead of just going 1, 2, 3. Because these are floats, we have to actually give them float values. Otherwise, we'd get a message came back. So two methods do the same thing, but the second one reads much easier. I don't know. I prefer this method, actually. This one actually reads easier to me than this label. But what if you had first name, last name, date of birth? Wouldn't it be nice to know this is the first name, this is the last name, this is the date of birth? It's like SQL. I'm trying to, when you do an insert on a record, it's like, how am I going to know which order what everything is? So I'm going to insert this first name is equal to this, last name is equal to this. It's a little bit easier in terms of reading it. So I read the detailed explanation in the lecture notes. Okay, yeah. Initializers. Here we have the initializer, and this is basically the kind of the syntax of the dynamic typing that I kind of wanted to at least cover this evening. So the initializer with arguments, example from Hello World. ID is a generic data type. This is give me an object. It's kind of like object, actually. ID says it's not a float, it's not a double, it's anything. Anything can be assigned to ID. Init with number n and value v. Number is equal to n, value is equal to v, return self. This is init. We know it's an initializer because it starts out with init. In the old days, people just said init, 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 init. In Java, the constructor has the same name as the class. In Objective-C, it starts out with init. Just the rule. The big difference is the return self at the end. We know it returns self, which means it initializes. Because we need to get self out of that. Until we get self, we haven't gotten an object that's initialized. Then we can call self, self this, self that. And the return type of ID, this is dynamic typing. ID is the same as void in C. It's actually, there's no return. But actually, ID is it's confusing in this context. You can actually use it as a data type. It means it's nothing. It's not an integer, it's not a float. It's void, but it means something slightly different in different contexts, and I'll get to that as we go through. You can use it for a data type for data members. So you can have first name that's an ID, or an object that's an ID that you created. So then we can write IAD is equal to HW, which is equal to hello world alloc. Huh? In it with, this is the equivalent to reading it to creating a constructor call. Initializer is much better, but still not totally correct in this particular case. But we have hello world alloc, which means create a new hello world object. We can put that in a separate line, and then we can just put hello world in it with numbers, which is this constructor up here, and values. So init with number n and value v, so 3 and 3.7. And then we said ID, and this is the data type of the object HW, homework, or whatever. So the call to alloc returns a new object. To this object, we should send init by sending the inherited init to the class, to the parent class, which is where init comes from. It's NS objects initializer. So unless you write an initializer, you always have to initialize it, but you don't necessarily have to write a specialized initializer for it. It's just the same way as you can create a class without a constructor. But you have to call init to return self. So the initializer should continue only if the init succeeds. So in here we have super init. Remember super in Java? Those of you who didn't take the Java class. It's like going back, supering back to the constructor of the default constructor or whatever constructor we want to. Actually, we can super back to anything of the previous class that we inherited from. So here is init with number n and value n. It's the same code as before. If not self, then super back to init. Then we've got self from init, which means go back. So if it hasn't succeeded, send the inherited init to its parents class. We can actually just run init from the object, which is what we've been seeing so far in the iPhone. We don't have initializers for these objects. We just say init, which says run the initializer of the super object. So here we have, and then this is, everything's a pointer. Everything's dynamically allocated. This is just like the dots, but it's C++, C code. Self dot number, but we're using this notation because it's really a pointer. Which I have to talk about eventually. The whole call becomes more complicated, but it's explained in the more detail as we go through. So I'll go through examples of initializers, and eventually after the third or fourth example, you'll get the point, maybe, hopefully. We just basically at this point, remember you have to allocate it and you have to initialize it. And you can write an initializer, and the key is it has the word init, starts out with init. If you don't have any initializers, you run the init, which is the plain init from NS object. Everybody extends from NS object, which is interesting. So here's a new class, and we have the at interface student. And this says extends in Java, but it's the colon in Objective-C. NS object is where we're coming from. In Java, if we didn't have anything, we just said class, my class. We don't say extend object. But here we have to say NS object, which is kind of interesting, because I guess theoretically this could be for multiple platforms and we can extend other things. But in the iPhone and also in Objective-C programming and for the regular Mac OS X, it's NS object. So NS string, and this is a pointer variable here. I like to put the pointers actually closer to the name. I'll talk about pointers next time. Name, float GPA, which is two data members. A string and a float. Everything is NS string because it's coming from the COCA interface. And init, this is the interface, remember, it's the .h file. ID, generic, init, that's our constructor kind of thing. ID again, init student, another one. So as we have another, remember we had the default constructor, we have another constructor, it takes on a parameter, this one's going to take on the name, it's going to take on NS string. Pointer, don't worry about the pointer right now, name. And then we have, it's also going to set the float GPA, this colon here, word wrapped is really the same line. So this particular constructor takes on two arguments, a name and a GPA. It's going to set both of the data pieces. So in the class student here in the implementation, so we know this is the .h because it says interface up here. We know this is the .m because it says implementation up here. Implementation of student. It is case sensitive as well. We have to capitalize the S in student because we capitalized it over here. This is capital. We're going to write the code for this, and here's our code again. So we have init here, the default initializer. So think of initializer as a constructor. So super init, call super init, which is self, and then return nil, so if not. So this is, if not, so if it doesn't return, return nil, which means if it's nil, it means the object wasn't created. Otherwise, return yourself. So we have a pointer. That basically just says, give me the pointer for where you're loaded in memory. And self will say, where am I? Here you are, up here. And that's, you're calling self to find you in memory, is essentially. And then we're reading and writing to the memory because everything's a reference. Because everything's dynamically allocated. Which is like pointers on steroids. And if you don't like pointers, you don't like this at all. But some of you who come from the Java class have never heard of pointers, so that's a good thing. So, self.name is this, self.gba is this, return self. This one's going to return self as well. We always return self from the initializer. This is the second one where we have init students, and we're taking on the float. And this is just the implementation for the method that we specified. And here, otherwise, this is going to be name. This is going to be GPA. So we're doing the same thing. We're taking on the parameters from the method call to initialize. We're taking those parameters, and we're populating the values with the data members that belong to this particular class object that we've created. Same thing we did in Java. Slightly different syntax, however. This is equivalent to the dot. So instead of saying this dot name is equal to name, this dot GPA is equal to GPA, we're saying self, because now this is called self, and then this is the pointer instead of the dot. So the notation is the same in C, actually, when you start using pointers. So. And the typical question I ask at this particular point that I asked also in the Objective-C class is, how many people have never heard of pointers? How many people want to hear about more pointers? Do I need to bring in more pointer information?
So like reference?
Yeah. I can probably cover pointers without going into that much detail with them. With Objective-C examples. But I can also explain them from a C perspective. By show of hands, how many people want C pointer information? Nobody, that's very good. Thank you. I was not looking forward to that. Okay, good. So we'll just proceed forward. If at any particular time you want more information on a particular subject, because I'm going through Objective-C at the speed of light, because this is really an iPhone class, then let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to assume you're catching on. You also, because you're taking this class simultaneously with another class that happens to be going on simultaneously, you could cheat the system a little bit. If you're not in the iPhone, if you're not in the Objective-C programming course, you can still be in the Objective-C programming course because you can still watch the videos of everything that was recorded from it. And that's going on simultaneously because I know some of you are just in this class. You can come out here and watch the lectures and see, like for example, I haven't put it up here yet, but the one from today would actually help you in terms of the pointers, because I went over pointers today. This whole entire class is on Objective-C. We're only covering enough to be semi-proficient on the iPhone. You seriously need to take a full class in Objective-C if you want to learn. If you want to be productive, only because the iPhone, although you can do the GUI, in order to get the functionality working, you have to have programmed something. So, all right, as promised, we're going to leave at a respectable time. So I'll see you on Wednesday with source code examples.